Fan.
AA Big Ten women's and men's basketball tournaments are headed to Target Center March 6th through the 17th. Head over to our contest page. Register for your chance to win a pair of tickets to either tournament. It's KFAN.com. Keyword contest to enter.
Now it's so cold in your doorway that I can hardly breathe. You know I want to lay down, but I'm afraid I'll freeze.
651 area code guy writes, have you considered the fact that good teams throw the ball less because they're usually leading? For someone who has watched football as long as you have, I wouldn't think that that needs to be explained. But here we are. 651 guy, I appreciate the thought, and there's some truth to it, but I would say respectfully to him, has he watched the Vikings this season? The Vikings have given up on the run game no matter the score. It's not like when we're down 28-3, we've got to throw. That's not how it works. Mark Craig made that very clear in what he wrote today as well. And it's also a bit of an oversimplification because there are teams who value the ground game more. Niners have a... Now, you can say, well, it's easier for the Niners to do that because they've got Christian McCaffrey. I wouldn't disagree with you. But it all fits together. It's part of how you evaluate. So even if the breakdowns are, well, he's thrown as much as he has, as ridiculous as it's been since Cousins went out, because that's a whole, that's the part to me that is where he failed the most as a coach. We can have the discussion with Kirk, who now has a handle on this. He's coming into his own, allegedly, with this offense and now understands it, knows how all the toys work, etc. But the idea that they continue to throw as often without Kirk as with them is reckless. I'm sorry. It just is. Might not have made any difference, but it still doesn't make any sense. But there are teams who either because, and if other teams are better running in part because they have a better running back or they have a better offensive line, that's part of the evaluation we're talking about. It's part of what counts. It's if the comeback is, well, they just didn't block very well, and we didn't have that kind of running back, that too is an indictment. Maybe not as much in the head coach as it is the organization, but there were too many times where I felt he gave up on it too fast, even in games where they were running okay. I just don't think it interests him as much. We've talked about the reasons for that. So I don't think you can put it all down to, well, yeah, if you're ahead, you don't really have to throw. You get to the second halves of games, yeah, that's certainly part of the deal, but does 651 area code guys, has he watched the Niners? Is he aware of the value they put on the ground game being an important part of what they do? I don't know. Raven's another example of that. I'm not exactly sure. I mean, does that make any sense to you?
It does. What he said, no. I mean, it does, but it doesn't. Yeah. It does, but it doesn't. It doesn't have those numbers. I mean, I'm sure you can find an analytic for when you're running a play scoreboard independent, like where you're not down by two touchdowns, where you have to throw it with. You know what I mean? Like, it's just the feel of the whole thing. And there were times where they just didn't establish it, and they didn't stay ahead of it, and they didn't cultivate.
And again, some of it wasn't good enough. And that
might be a lot of it.
But
yeah,
that's part of what has to be resolved, or you're going to be. I know this is a sacrilege for the Kirk Cobos. I don't trust Kirk enough, even in his allegedly improved state, even though the team had a 4-4 record, I think, with him as the quarterback this season, to say, Mahomes, you throw as many times as you need to, and you can handle it. And in fairness to Kirk, I don't know who I do trust that. As I said, I didn't even trust Aaron Rodgers this last few years at the Packers that way, and they didn't either. They said, well, we got to take some of that stuff off of his plate, and it was rather effective. As much as football has changed, I think the irony for me, and this is what I don't understand why KOC doesn't get it, the irony is to get the most efficient passing game, at the key times. If you have help from the running game, that will enhance what you have. Doesn't mean you have to, you know, go 50-50 on your breakdown. It just means that's going to give, that's going to open the door to a lot more stuff if we can actually create that kind of threat. A couple people have suggested that I ask PJ Fleck to start calling plays, because I'm the guy who's usually ripping PJ Fleck for not wanting to throw, and that is the irony of this.
He sticks with the run.
It's more of there's a balancing act that needs to go on, and I think to that extent, both coaches for different reasons have tended to fail that, at least too much for me. Dan, this is John in Shakopee. This is why San Francisco is so good. They do not let ego get in the way. They traded up for a QB, moved on from him after a few years. That's John from Shakopee. Well, they got lucky, or maybe not. Maybe they were smart about
maybe getting Mr. Irrelevant was who they wanted all along.
Maybe it's exactly it. I'm not sure, but you know, they are. I don't think they're guaranteed to win the bowl, but they're stout where, more than anything else, as much as we're talking about all of this, the line of scrimmage.
The trenches.
And that's been another big issue that I can't put this on the head coach, but that's still an ongoing concern I have, is we don't have that kind of excellence at the line of scrimmage, which, by the way, I think helps make everything, pretty much everything, look better. We'll say we got at least two or three more Vikings talking points to get to. We got Lieber coming up at 4:46. I do plan in the 5 o'clock hour to open the phone portal. We'll allow people to vent, or maybe to defend the current condition of the Minnesota Vikings. Get into the issue of what they want to do with number 8, Kirk Cousins. Let me get to a couple more texts real quick. Oh, 612, how long has Zimmer been hosting the 3 to 6:30 slot? Well, I'll be honest. As much as Zim could have used a little of KOC's liberated thinking.
Did you see the game?
This year especially, I think KOC could have used a little of Zim's constipation, if you want to call it that. That's kind of negative, pejorative way to look at it. But I've said this two or three times this year that I thought we needed to Zimmerize a little bit, especially post number 8, when you know, once he went down, and you're just throwing a bunch of suspects out there. By the way, did anybody talk to Pastrnak after the game?
I didn't see any quotes from him.
Poor guy. I mean, we hardly knew he.
Yeah.
Think about it. He was the number one sports celebrity in town for, was it 2 weeks?
In about 2.5, 3 in space. He was like Halley's Comet. But now you're going to see him every 75 years, apparently.
I don't even, maybe he's not, maybe he wasn't even with the team, for all we know.
He was supposed to be the backup.
I think he was supposed to be the backup. You're right. He wasn't the emergency. He was the backup.
But we saw Cousins more than we saw him.
And they don't even show the Pastrnak.
This week on The Fan.
The Upper Midwest's biggest boat sale is back. The Discover Boating Minneapolis Boat Show, in partnership with Progressive Insurance, is headed to the Minneapolis Convention Center January 18th through the 21st. Head over to our contest page for your chance at a family four-pack of tickets. KFAN.com, keyword contest.
What was your favorite Marcus Davenport moment?
First and 10, Kansas City, as Patrick Mahomes goes out of the shotgun, pumps, he's hit, gets away from it, but then they got him! Marcus Davenport will be credited with the sack that was started by Danielle Hunter. So Hunter has one, Davenport has one, loss of 8. Three receivers right and Aiden Hurst to the left. Adam Thielen inside slot right. Young, back to pass on third down, sees nothing. Marcus Davenport got him! Marcus Davenport, with his first sack as a member of the Minnesota Vikings, drives back the Carolina Panthers, and Johnny Hecker is in to punt.
Believe.
Who have we seen less of in the last month and change? Marcus Davenport or Pastrnak? It's pretty close. We found, I think, the only two. I think you found the only two Marcus Davenport highlights right there. I think you found them.
He had a couple of sacks back-to-back weeks there.
Honestly.
That was it.
And you can't swing and miss in free agency any worse than the Vikings did on him. And I, as I said Sunday, I was accused of, well, that's an easy second guess. We were first guessing on Davenport. Not because we'd studied the All-22, but just because, oh, man, this guy's been out a lot. You're projecting. It almost felt like a Twins acquisition, you know, where you go, well, you know, when he was good, he was really good. And what if he catches fire?
In 2018.
And wakes up the echoes.
Yep.
He was a disaster, as Mark Craig also wrote about today. He notes that there were 16 free agents who got deals averaging at least what Davenport got, 13 mil for 2023. The other 15, entering week 18, were averaging 745 snaps in 15 games. Davenport played 118 snaps in four games.
And that's a fact.
Underachieving and landing on injured reserve long ago. Capstrap's team needed a shrewd signing for Flores' pressure-based defense. Davenport's salary matched that of Green Bay's Preston Smith, who entered Week 18 with 8 sacks, 696 snaps, and 16 starts. Meanwhile, former Vikings, Za'Darius Smith, remember him?
Z, in Cleveland?
Traded to Cleveland. He entered Week 18 with 16 starts for a playoff team. His salary? Less than Davenport's.
That's 11.7.
Mill. So that wasn't a second guess, boys and girls. That was a first guess. And, you know, you can always do the old, well, how do you account for injuries? You can't, but in his case, there were alarm bells all over the place about his ability to stay healthy, most recently for sure. And again, for a team as strapped as these guys are, that's...
You can't afford mistakes.
That's a blunder.
Like that.
Yeah. And again, that's a blunder that has nothing to do with things that are, you know, quote-unquote, beyond your control. There were a lot of people questioning how much emphasis you were putting on this guy and how badly you kind of needed this guy to find himself again and reemerge. And it was, again, I'm assuming that is over. I don't think we're going to be bringing him back next year.
Maybe at a discount.
Well,
hometown discount.
Yeah, I guess it's possible.
But yeah, we waited for him to be ready. Then he was, and he teased.
He did tease briefly.
Two nice plays.
A couple of nice active games.
Yep.
Parts of games.
And that was it.
And then it was gone. I mean, it was like, it was another meteor. He was here, and he was gone. Or is it a comet? What's the difference between a comet and a meteor?
I don't know.
I wish
we could have Josh Dobbs on. We could have asked him.
He'd have known.
Yeah, absolutely.
He knows.
He knows.
I can't believe somebody didn't try to get a hold of him today. Isn't this the exit interview day?
Yes.
The last chance, right?
Locker room was open, I believe.
Damn.
Yeah. Kwesi and KOC are going to talk on Wednesday morning, it sounds like.
Jason from Egan, I think you guys hit the most important point of all this. That's how badly the offensive defensive line still need to be upgraded. I would be all in on signing Cousins for two more years if we were that close to winning something meaningful. We're not. Oh, by the way, that's another important aspect of running the ball more effectively or even moderating your passing game a little bit is that we don't have the kind of, we don't have, for example, the Detroit Lions offensive line. We don't. We don't have the 49ers offensive
right.
line.
It was and better so for a long time this year, and then it seems like it went off a cliff.
And again, some of that might have been with a backup QB making, you know, the starter would have made quicker reads, etc. But, and then we'd had some injuries that factored in too. But we're back to, if you don't have a great offensive line, you have to do number 8 a favor and help him out by giving him some other ways to move the football. And once he's out, you especially need to do that with backup quarterbacks as well. It's all some things you have to concede. If we had the kind of offensive line that would just allow, we're just going to line up, we're just going to throw it as often as we want to, that might make some sense, but we don't have that. And guess what happens when you throw a lot more? You turn the ball over. That's all part of the deal as well. You end up turning the ball over. You you can't eliminate, but maybe you lessen that hurt if you're not constantly trying to fling the ball all over the ballpark. Get to a couple of other texts here. I've got Ben Lieber coming up at about 4:46 today. What's the name of that jazz song coming back from your last break? It was a jazz song, but I don't remember which one it was. Do you?
It was Miles Davis, Stella by Starlight.
Stella by Starlight, a Miles Davis classic. Does anyone in the studio between 3 to 6 know there's a grand in your hand cash contest going on? I didn't think that started till next week.
Let me look.
We'll find out.
Now that you mention it, it sounds correct.
All right, so we have some catching up to do there. How's that work?
Missed an hour.
Okay.
But I can give you this one. It's grand. Fan in the Big Ten Conference want to give you a shot to put a grand in your hand. KFAN.com, keyword grand. Sheet wasn't where it normally was. But that's on me. Everything that happens in the studio is on me. 100% my responsibility.
Which Josh pulled the bigger disappearing act, Dobbs or Freeman? Well, Freeman, because Freeman didn't
never arrived.
He never arrived.
Yeah.
I mean,
you can't disappear if you were never there.
Freeman was awful the only time we played. He only played one game, right?
Yes.
That was literally here and gone.
The Monday night game against the Giants.
And he threw it like 57 times.
10 years
Speaking
ago.
Speaking of that, doing nothing but throwing the ball. And at least one of the passes ended up in the crowd. I remember that. One of those on the sidelines, it ended up actually landing in the crowd.
And another in Secaucus from East Rutherford.
Some accuracy issues there, one could say. Paul writes, love the show. You're the only show on the Fan willing to take on the controversial Cuz Buzz topic head on. Other radio shows dance around it or toe the company line. We love Cuz Buzz. He's the chosen one. He's the only one that can run this offense. We don't want to upset JJ by not bringing him back, blah, blah. Sounds like Paul's ready to move on. And as I said, it's not even a matter of a stinging indictment of number 8.
No, it makes sense.
I have not seen enough to believe that you bring him back, you're going to go far. I just don't. I think he's been here long enough now that we kind of know what he is. I know people want to believe he was just about to take off, and he had statistically some very nice games. But he also had the defense stole the Carolina game. He threw a pick six in that game that could have cost him. And so I'm not here again to say he's terrible, but I just don't project we bring him back and everything is going to work. And that's the danger of losing any starting quarterback is you start to romanticize, you project, I think, beyond his true worth, because in comparison to who you threw out there instead of him, especially if you use the suspects that the Vikings tried to throw out there, he is going to look better than he is. And when you factor in all of the other issues this team has, again, it doesn't even have to be you're critical of him. You're saying we played it out as long as we could. It's unfortunate you got hurt when you did. Now we can get a QB, and now we got to go out and try to fill some other positions as well, pretty much across the board. Bottom of the hour pause. Lieber coming up at about 4:46. We're going to take some phone calls in the 5 o'clock hour. More talking points and another National Football League controversy that broke.
Bumper on the Fan.
Are you ready for an unforgettable night of country music? Chris Stapleton's All-American Roadshow is coming to U.S. Bank Stadium Saturday, April 6th, with special guests Lainey Wilson and Marcus King. Tickets are on sale now. You can head over to KFAN.com, keyword calendar, for more info.
About the way you've been for.
A kerfuffle at the end of the Saints Falcons game, and I made the mistake of only reading the headline. In this case, I didn't follow the Barrero edict, which is to follow the story, and it sounded very much like a coach who knew he was about to get dismissed,
Arthur Smith,
was cranky about the fact that his team got destroyed in a game that they were obviously trying to win to keep their slim playoff hopes alive, and he was bitter about a late touchdown scored by the Saints. The Saints won big, didn't it? It was like 44-20 or something.
And he did get fired today, maybe last night.
No, I think he did.
Night.
I think it was actually early this morning. Regardless, he is out. and he was bitter, and I assumed that this was another coach, like I said, who...
Doing the Brewster?
Yeah, was wanted to change the subject from the fact that his team was awful with its season on the line, and that he knew he was going to be fired, so he just went scorched earth. What I didn't know in this case was, because I went with the old, which I believe, stop him. You know, I don't care how late, I used to worry about things like how late you threw the ball. By the way, I'm talking about in competitive leagues, okay? I'm talking about a game featuring two Big Ten teams. I'm talking about a game featuring two National Football League teams. I'm not talking about like a public high school and a private Christian school that's playing basketball for the first time. And
it's 102 at halftime. 100,
yeah, that's a horse of a different color, yep. Okay? But I just, because I think it's just exhausting.
You don't
exhausting.
Think a private Christian school can hang?
Well, in some cases, yes. In some cases, no, apparently. But that's in my head because I think that just happened again recently.
Uh-huh.
But it's just exhausting about, well, how many minutes is okay? Can I throw? Can I not throw?
Right.
What if I run and
what's
I just
the yard
keep
line?
Running? It's just stop them. But in this case, the dastardly part was the Saints head coach had ordered a kneel down.
Dennis Allen.
Yep. Ordered a kneel down.
Victory formation.
The players were trying to get, I don't know the name of the running back, a touchdown. Whoever it was, they basically ignored the play call. And what I guess I'm still unclear on, did it start as if it looked like they were going to kneel down?
Yes.
And then he hands the ball off?
Yes.
Okay.
It was a straight-up victory formation.
And then you hand
Jameis
the ball
takes
off.
The snap. He hands it off to the running back, right. And he runs in for a touchdown.
So there, that's, even for me, as in the stop him guy, kind of indefensible because you're not really even having a chance to stop him, right? You're doing the old, I mean, cause, and the way victory formation is done in the league now is, if you're a defensive player and you try to like break through and dive over the top,
100%,
you get nailed.
You get in trouble.
So that most teams have figured out victory formation. There's no play here. I'm not going to be the jerk and try to cause trouble and cause agitation just because I'm bitter that we're at the other end of kneel down. So,
and at that point, they're down 41-17.
Yeah. Well, and again, at that point, to me, the score doesn't matter. If you're in kneel down, yeah, well, you're right. It does matter. I guess if it was tied. We've seen fake
spikes
yep. that have worked effectively. I think Marino did one.
Yeah, we've seen them.
Mistaken. But so in this case, I can't with a straight face say to the Atlanta Falcons, well, stop them. Because you didn't think you were going to have to stop them in that play because they were saying the game's over and we're kneeling down. And then you hand the ball off. So they have found, the Saints have identified the one, for me, I guess, exception to the rule where I cannot be upset with a team getting its ass kicked, being upset that they were put in this position by the other team.
Mostly because, like you said, I've heard a lot of defensive players say this today. When it's victory formation, we're not going to try to do anything. We're not going to try to hurt anybody. We're right. all conceding.
Yes.
The white flag is up for
it's
everybody.
Up, right.
We all know. And isn't it just perfect that it's Jameis that's at the center of this whole thing?
Yes.
And Dennis Allen, you know, goes to the podium and says, you know, it's not Saints football, basically. That's not what we're about. That's not the type of team we are.
Yes.
Then they go to Jameis in the locker room. I don't know if you saw this.
No.
And he just goes, yeah, I mean, the team, it was a team decision. And I talked to DA about it. And we didn't want to do the kneel down, basically. We just wanted to run a play.
In all honesty, what does it, if you're the ownership, do the Bensons still own the Saints?
They could. Maybe the wife. Yeah.
Or do they sell? I don't know. But isn't that a bit of an alarm bell about the control your head coach has? Honest to God, right? They basically say, we don't have to pay attention to you. It doesn't really matter.
Nobody has control over Jameis Winston at any given point. It doesn't matter. Bill Belichick couldn't tell Jameis Winston what to do. It wouldn't matter.
That might be true.
And the best part, well, there's so many funny parts about it, but he fist bumps and celebrates like it was to get into the Super Bowl.
Right,
when it was Jamal Williams who had the one-yard touchdown with just over a minute left. And, yeah, he celebrates like they've just done something unbelievable, and obviously they didn't.
With Garzy's plan of Cousins plus draft a QB, I'm curious if you think the Pack's strategy of draft and sit is going to catch on or remain an outlier strategy for QBs. I think re-signing Cousins as a bridge makes a lot of sense. That's Glenn in New Hope. Love sat 1 year or two?
At least two.
He's hit two?
Yeah.
Okay.
At least.
How high did was Love taken? Do you remember?
Love was in the 20s, if I remember right.
But he was in the first round?
Yes.
Okay. Yeah. All right.
Mahomes sat
here. Well, here's what I would say. How do I put this? I don't think... I know people want to believe the best thing to do is actually to let those even high picks sit. I've come to believe there should be no rule about it, that it might well serve the interests of some young quarterbacks. But we've seen some young quarterbacks step in immediately and be quite effective. So to me, it's a strategy you can use, but I still believe it would be easier to accept this strategy for me here if I didn't have the number of holes in other places with the salary cap challenges, because that's the other goofy thing. I mean, we're in this position where we have several players who are demanding huge contracts, even though we stunk as a team this year. And I get it, because it's not the fault of those individual players. But I continue to believe that, in a sense, we're putting off the inevitable. And I think this is the perfect time to stop putting it off, that this is the time to say, yeah, it's not going to be fun, and it's not going to be easy, because we got to draft well and we got to be right, but we can't just keep, whether you're talking about from a salary cap situation or just in terms of a growth situation, you know, putting off what we know is inevitable. I it's almost like the Vikings think they can put it off forever, and I don't think that's ever taken place very effectively. I just don't think that works.
Jordan Love, number 26th overall pick in 2022. I'm sorry, in 2020. So he sat 2020, 21, 22. So he sat four years.
Three. Oh, 20, he's drafted in 20? Okay, yeah. All right.
22.
Yeah,
so it's right. 3 years.
You had Salisbury on week 3 or 4 when everyone said trade Cousins. Sean's take was that immediately the Vikings would be a worse team. More recently, I think, it sounds like Salisbury thinks they should recommit to Cousins. We just had him on last Thursday. I believe that's true. We'd have been in the playoffs. I like Garzy's option. Draft a QB at 11 and bring Cousins back. Think about this. Josh Freeman is the same age as Kirk Cousins. Is that true?
I don't know.
Very, very possible. That's for sure. Let's get a pause in. We got Ben Lieber.
Nacho. Might be a little younger.
Let's see what Nacho has to say about where the Vikings, how he views the season and where he thinks the purple should go from here, who he thinks is going to be back and who isn't. We haven't even talked at all about Harrison Smith, who sounded almost like a guy who was about to retire, but maybe that was the emotion of a long season coming to a not very satisfactory conclusion. We'll talk about that in